individual hospital or clinician call us. There are some clues to some of these agents. I've already mentioned this sort of widened middle part of the chest on x-ray for anthrax, the characteristic rash of smallpox. Botulism actually is probably the easiest thing to diagnose, but some other diseases like plague are less specific. The other thing we're trying to educate clinicians about is this unusual disease pattern. If you see sort of unusual features in previously healthy adults, a pox-like rash in adults who've had chickenpox is not, especially if they're healthy, there are some things that can cause that, but to at least consider smallpox, unusual clusterings in time, like flu outbreaks in the summertime, unusual diseases that just don't occur here, like plague, and West Nile, which I think is the next slide, shows us the value of also monitoring our wildlife as well as our human life. This slide just shows you how powerful one physician's phone call can be. This is the four cases that of West Nile that we knew about. This is the day they were admitted, but it took a couple of days before reporting. The first call came in on the 23rd, and we actually started investigating, I think it was two cases, but by this day we became aware of four, and these two patients were much sicker. And these cases were reported by one physician and led us to recognize West Nile. The sad thing on this slide is that the cases in orange were in the hospital with encephalitis, which was reportable but had not been called into us. So it shows me how lucky I was to detect this, that it really relied on one physician seeing something unusual and calling us. So I show this slide every opportunity I get, whenever, no matter what I'm talking about in public health. So there's no question, probably we'll detect a bioterrorist event because a physician sees something unusual and does the right thing and calls us. And we start investigating, including active surveillance, and recognize a citywide outbreak or a clustered outbreak. But we recognize in New York City it's a complicated place. There are 40,000 physicians, 70 hospitals. Despite our efforts, we're never going to reach every single physician and keep all these issues in the back of their mind. And also, by the time someone's sick enough in the hospital, it's probably several days into the illness. So we've invested a lot of our resources in something we call syndromic surveillance, which is to detect a sort of citywide cluster in non-specific illness earlier to give us a little bit more heads up to respond. And specifically, we look for influenza-like illness. It's a very common initial prodrome for almost all of the diseases. I'm not going to spend any time explaining this slide. This is our 911 system. But every day in New York City right now, we look at EMS runs by the type of complaint when the patient calls in or the family calls in. We also do the same thing with emergency room data, where we analyze it by syndrome daily and geographically to even pick up a small localized cluster in the city. And because we've been on this enhanced state of alert since 911, we're probably more aggressive about investigating relatively small clusters because of the increased concerns. We're moving towards adding a pharmacy surveillance to this to monitor over-the-counter sales of anti-pharmaceuticals, and we also started doing employee health surveillance with the FDA because of concerns about a release in the subway. This is a slide that got me in trouble a couple of years ago for presenting it at a national conference, but it sort of lists the issues that I think everyone at every level in the public health and medical care community needs to ask themselves. Are we ready? And I think there are very few places in the country that are 100% ready. I think we can all, there are additional things all of us recognize we need to do. This question is easier to answer than it was even a year ago. I think many of my colleagues thought that I was spending way too much time on something that would never happen, and I think very few of them would say that today. I think this is the hard part, because yes, it is possible to be 100% prepared, but it's going to cost a lot of money, and will the political will be there in the long run to maintain that? Is obviously, and it won't be cheap, and how to balance that with real public health issues is the concern. From our perspective here in New York City, obviously this is a relatively low probability for happening in a large scale, but the consequences are high. And because of that, and because there is a potential for prevention, is why we've justified spending the time and resources on this that we have. This just shows that we are just one of the first responders, that we recognize the need to involve and engage everyone in the medical care community, as well as our counterparts in emergency management and law enforcement. Here in New York City, we've actually, Jerry Hauer was a former head of the Office of Emergency Management, and Peggy Hamburg was commissioner 5 years ago, when they sort of took the unusual step for a local health department or a local municipality to begin thinking about it before hardly anyone else was. And we've had support at the very highest levels of local government. The mayor has been unbelievably supportive of this effort. We obviously have a large health department compared to most local agencies in the country. And there's no question, both from every agency, it's not just the health departments, all of us have started to rev up our planning efforts since September 11th. I think for time, I won't go into a lot of detail, but I think the biggest issue for us was, again, the fact that we traditionally were a 9-to-5, for the most part, agency with one doctor on call to handle individual calls over off hours. But we recognized the need to sort of implement an emergency response command structure that was first put into place with West Nile, sort of used in, at least preparatively, for Y2K, and came in great after the WTC as well as the anthrax events. I've already mentioned the importance of surveillance, the need to enhance our laboratory capacity we recognize, and all the pre-planning. You don't have time to develop questionnaires and protocols when an event occurs, and we actually had a lot of pre-prepared investigations and had talked to the FBI and PD about how we would go and investigate. So the first time we needed to use it, it wasn't something new. And we had draft protocols for all of the BT agents that we sort of decided not to publicize because we didn't want them advertised, but we recognize the need now to get them out. The anthrax one is out, and hopefully the others will be out shortly. And then there's a lot of general disaster planning that's true for any emergency, whether it's biologic or otherwise. Obviously, communication, I think, is the biggest challenge, and there's some things went well nationally with the anthrax. Obviously, a lot did not. Our biggest responsibility, at least in my office at Communicable Diseases, is to ensure that we're getting information to the medical community directly. Right now, we do that through this broadcast alert system that's both fax and email. Probably the smartest thing I did after, our building is right near the World Trade Center, and we evacuated it on September 12th. We actually worked through the night there, September 11th, and we were given an hour to evacuate to go move uptown. And the one thing I decided to take with me when I didn't have much time to think was our broadcast computer system so that I could communicate with hospitals for the 2 weeks we were based uptown and then dragged it back down with me. So I'm very glad that we did that. But this is how we communicate. We're actually working on developing a secure internet site to improve that. We have gotten much better, though nothing's perfect, of setting up public hotlines that we can staff and train to answer all sorts of calls. And this poor staff, with every day they were getting sort of revised information, it was hard to keep them up to date with all the changing events that first week of the anthrax outbreak. Obviously, the internet is something we're taking better advantage of. The need, whenever we do anything, to do it in many different languages is something we recognize always. And that in any bioterrorist event, there's been some criticism that non-medical people are the speakers, but the truth is that, politics is politics and they're going to want to be there. And our role as public health agencies is to make sure that if they are the message giver, one, hopefully have a physician at their side to answer the medical questions, but make sure they're as well informed as possible. And the need we recognize to work closely with the media, be available, and to make sure that the information is getting across okay, because that's how most people, including the medical community, will get their information. This slide is just to acknowledge that they're probably the biggest concern from the anthrax perspective for a large outbreak is the need to get antibiotics to potentially a large number of people quickly. And there is something called the National Pharmaceutical Stockpile that's owned by CDC that theoretically can bring a lot of antibiotics quickly. We actually got this here right after the World Trade Center. And then it can be replenished through a sort of inventory. This is what it looks like. It's just two-thirds of a push pack. This is what came. Unfortunately, it comes like this. And it doesn't, and these are all lots of pills in big boxes. The real challenge is breaking this down and getting it out quickly. But there is a very detailed plan that we've been working on for almost a year with our emergency management agency that, ironically enough, was to be tested. The plan was, there have been pre-selected sites throughout the city that obviously the challenge of getting the staff trained we were just beginning to address. But the ideal was to move people through quickly so we could prophylax, if needed, the whole city within 48 hours, and the plan for this is sort of schematized here, and we were going to pilot test this on September 12th at Pier 92, which is now the home of our Office of Emergency Management. So we do hope to do this. It's something we've been working on also with Cornell University, some researchers there. I'm not going to go into any detail here, but I think something that everyone recognizes is that though public health has gotten some resources recently from the federal government, hospitals, which are going to be the real first responders, have sort of been left out of the funding structure. stream for preparing, and they're being asked a lot without any money to support that, and the concerns given the state that many hospitals in this country are in, and what to really prepare will require resources to ensure sufficient surge capacity and the ability to handle large numbers of infectious patients. So I do think this is something important to lobby for, and again, the surge capacity is the biggest issue. There's a number of research needs from bioterrorism about all these agents. I think the one thing I've learned in the past couple weeks is that we really didn't know very much about anthrax, even though it's been around for a while. All the textbook descriptions of it, some of them were true, but not all of them, especially about weaponized anthrax. As far as the federal response, this is my slide, my opinion only, but there's a lot of needs for improving infrastructure. Surveillance nationwide is not what it needs to be. The experts at CDC and anthrax are my age or younger, so these are people who've actually seen, I think we've seen more cases of anthrax now than they have up close, and the need to sort of build up expertise in rare diseases is something that's been unfortunately not well maintained. Lots of research and development is needed for antibiotics and vaccines and so forth. The need to enhance these stockpiles, including the smallpox vaccine stockpile, is ongoing. This is my last, I think, general slide, and I'll quickly run through the recent anthrax events. But there's no question that the best way to prevent this from being an overwhelming disaster is to prevent it from happening in the first place. And the need to reinforce and strengthen this piece of paper is so apparent to me now. The need to ensure the inability to buy biologic agents in other parts of the world where it's still relatively easy and there's no security precautions in place. And the need to have better intelligence so we know better who has what so we can more realistically prepare. I'm kind of going to skip this for the sake of time. Lucille made this when she introduced me, is that a lot of this is not wasted money. It's sort of this audience, I'm hoping, sometimes I talk to people, they don't know what I'm talking about when I say double green stamps, but the double green stamps value of bioterrorism preparedness for both public health and the hospitals, it makes us better prepared to deal with any infectious disease outbreak. So there are some concerns about it's sort of driven by the military and a waste of resources, but I do not think that is true. And this is just to show you that a well-prepared infrastructure can respond. This is the last smallpox outbreak in New York City from 1947, when we had 12 cases in the city, and the health commissioner at the time decided, because of ongoing transmission, to vaccinate the entire city of New York. And within a several-week period, they vaccinated close to 6 million people. So it can be done, though I suspect the line would not look as well organized today without any lights and sirens and the National Guard on either side if we ever had to do this today. Is it okay to take a couple minutes on where Lucille is? I'm just going to wing through, I'll rush through this. The anthrax used to be called wolf sorters disease. That was the old occupational risk factor. Obviously today, the concern in the Postal Service because of the risk that they unexpectedly were put under when the anthrax envelopes went out. We had what we called enhanced bioterrorism surveillance in place prior to September 11th. Even the night of September, early in the morning of September 12th, when we were still stationed downtown, we began planning for sort of enhanced surveillance. We just sort of thought that the best time to hit us with a biologic agent is when we were down, and we were definitely down after the World Trade Center. We still don't have our phones back, and we were working nonstop on non-biologic issues. But we went ahead and set up a very active surveillance system of 15 emergency rooms in the city, had CDC staff, EIS officers, basically doing 24-hour coverage to monitor for unusual syndromes. We would analyze this data daily and investigate anything we saw unusual. And those alerts I mentioned went out almost every, at least twice a week. I don't think it was daily. After the Florida case happened of inhalational anthrax, even before it was acknowledged to be bioterrorism, I think many of us were skeptical. At the time, it seemed too close to where the terrorists had been stationed. There hadn't been an inhalational case in the U.S. in a very long time. So we just recognized the need to sort of more actively look for anthrax in the city, and we began some active outreach citywide to make sure we weren't missing a case. And as everyone knows, I felt like this was the case for the past few months. As soon as I thought we were over something, once again, we were struck, and I think everyone remembers this headline. But despite the fact that we were sort of preparing for it after Florida, I must tell you, it sort of even took me by surprise when first the NBC and then the other media sites were recognized that contaminated letters were sent. The total outbreak so far is 23 cases. So again, this wasn't a big outbreak. The inhalational cases, the good news is this number is actually better than expected. That were survivors. Here in New York City, we had 8 cases. One was the very well publicized fatal inhalational case. The rest were less severe and all doing well.